Perfect. So it's now 12:05. I will try to speak relatively slowly, definitely in a loud voice to make you fear at home, you know. And the topic is quite simple, but it's not quite known to, in general, it's not quite very well known, so I think everyone in this audience can find, or maybe can find, something interesting. First of all, regarding the topic, yesterday I was approached by Andy Strominger, and he noted, he told me, you know, ironically, your talk is the only one which has strings in the title and in the content. So I never thought that I would survive. Will I live up to that? So towards the end of the talk, I would like people who are really string theorists to tell me about, is it really a string, or as Sasha Polyakov likes to call it, string in the Pickwick sense. Pickwick, you know, posthumous papers of the Pickwick Club, Charles Dickens, with its incredible humor, British humor, I should say. Okay, I will start briefly with an old history, then a little bit of a last decade, and then I will come to the recent results. You know, this is the first example of the solitonic string in field theory. It was constructed 60 years ago in the context of the Ginzburg-Landau model of superconductivity by Alexey Abrikosov, who at that time he was just a graduate student. And Landau didn't particularly like this paper, so it just was left in Abrikosov's desk drawer for some time before it was published. Fortunately, it was, and 50 years later, it brought him the Nobel Prize. So it was a good graduate student work. Simultaneously, he invented, by the way, superconductor of the second type. And both Abrikosov strings and second type superconductors were discovered 10 years later in mid-1960. So what's the idea? We all know that if you have a Cooper pair, well, in the superconductors where charged Cooper pair condenses, magnetic field cannot penetrate inside unless it ruins the superconductivity. Empirically, this effect was of non-penetration of the magnetic field was discovered by Walter Meissner, early 1930. And at that time, of course, nobody knew about Cooper pairs, about their condensate, and it was explained, as I said, so there is a clash between two interests, you know, between the fact that the flux of the magnetic field only can end on the magnetic poles, south or north. It cannot be cut, it cannot be stopped in the middle, or it can go to infinity. And the fact that superconductivity doesn't tolerate the magnetic field, so there are two self-contradictory requirements, and as it happened, these requirements are, this clash was solved by a compromise, which is very good. I think that a compromise is a way to solve not only physics, but social problems too. So what happens, in fact, Cooper pairs are, the magnetic field is squeezed into a thin tube, and it is quantized inside the tube. The magnetic flux is transferred from here to here by quanta. If there are more than one quanta, then in superconductor of the second type, there would be a few tubes coming from the left to the right. Inside this tube, the superconductivity is destroyed. The condensate of the Cooper pairs vanishes. And that's why, and outside it has its non-perturbed value. So, and this is energetically the most advantageous solution. It's much more beneficial energetically than to spread the magnetic field all over in the Coulomb fashion. Now, theoretically, what this string solution, it's a very simple concept. You have a scalar, in the Ginzburg-Landau description, you have a scalar field which has a vacuum expectation value determined by the Ginzburg-Landau potential. But its phase far away from this string, it's if you go make a big circle around the string, far away, its phase can be arbitrary. So topological stability is achieved if you identify the phase of this Cooper pair field with the polar coordinate angle in the perpendicular plane. That's why it's pi 1, its topological stability is due to pi 1 of u1 is equal to z, so there are all possible windings are possible. When you rotate around, you can get the phase 2 pi, 4 pi, 6 pi, and that up to infinity. The thickness of the string is determined by the mass of the Higgs photon. Because charged field condenses, the U1 field acquires a mass, it is Higgs, and the inverse mass determines the thickness of the string. If you make the sample bigger, nothing happens inside the string, it just becomes bigger, but the tension of the strings stays the same, so there is confinement between north and south magnetic poles in this setup. This confinement is abelian, and in general, there are no... Here I show the second. If you don't have enough energy to excite the inner structure of the string, so if, so to say, if you look at this abricot of string from far aside, it is fully described by the coordinates of the string in the perpendicular plane. You can covariantize the description, then you can say that this is a four-dimensional string with zero thickness, no internal structure. It can be its action can be described by Nambu and Gatow construct, Nambu-Gatow construction. And then you start quantizing it. You know that in four dimensions you get into trouble with the general covariance because of the ghosts. Or maybe you don't get into trouble, but then you have to add the Liouville field, as Polyakov taught us. But if you go to 26 dimension for the purely bosonic string, or 10 dimension if you supersymmetrize it, then ghosts decouple, they are irrelevant, and you can quantize the string consistently, and that is the essence of the fundamental string. The string can end somewhere here and here, and this may be described as brains. Okay. This is already well-studied subjects. There are plenty of experts in this room. Now we want to do something else. And first I will briefly describe the setup and then make step back. And then I return to this setup. Now let's assume that in four dimensions we have a bulk theory, which is n equal, in this particular example, I will consider n equal to Young-Mills theory in the bulk with enough flavors. So each flavor is a hyper, it's n equal to, so each flavor is a hypermultiplet of the chiral hypermultiplet, which may or may not have mass, no mass term, okay? Otherwise I will get in trouble with n equal to. And the gauge group is un, not sun, but un. I need un, u1 factor in order to introduce the Fayet-Leopoulos term, which is crucial for the stability and BPS protection of the whole construction. And BPS protection will give me possibility in some cases to go to strong coupling, because there will be analytic expressions which can be analytically continued. Now this theory contains 8 supercharges in the bulk. It supports 1/2 BPS string-like solutions. The theory in the bulk can be made weak coupling to begin with, weakly coupled to begin with, and then if you want to and if you can, you can go to strong coupling. But what is important, 1/2 BPS saturated string will have 4 supercharges on the string walled sheet, which means that in terms of a two-dimensional theory on the string walled sheet, we will have n equal 2 supersymmetry in two dimensions too. It depends. Most often 2, 2, but sometimes it will be 0. I will tell you about this story. Now, for this whole story started maybe 10 years ago. In the first maybe 7 years or 6 years out of these 10, people focused on the case when the number of flavors, the number of hypers is equal to the number of colors. Yes?
I asked this question before, but
yeah?
I don't remember the answer.
Yeah.
What do you mean by non-abelian vortices?
I will come to that. When I will describe it, I will come to that. It's very easy, very easy. An f equal to n. Why it is a special case? This is the first number of an f when the... What happened? It's the for an f equal to n, the bulk theory is fully Higgs'd. Moreover, it is only fully Higgs'd, it acquires a global SUN symmetry. Okay? It's color flavor locked because there is gauge UN symmetry and there is flavor and SUN symmetry, and both of them are broken spontaneously, but the color flavor locked diagonal symmetry remains. Because of this, all gauge bosons acquire identical masses, and they all participate. We basically restore some SUN symmetry. All gauge bosons participate in the string formation completely unequal. It's not abelized situation like in your solution with Ed Wheaton when you have at low energy selected U1. I will, of course. As I said, you can find the theory on the string walled sheet in this case. And in this case, it turns out that in addition to translational moduli, the theory on the string walled sheet acquires orientational moduli, which are described generically by CPN -1 model. And if it is n equal 2 super Young Mielsen, the bulk, the theory is 2, 2. CPN -1 model on the walled sheet is 2, 2. Now you can introduce all sorts of deformations. For instance, you can deform it down to n equal 1. Then you get 0, 2, a heterotic string, or even you can deform it down to no supersymmetry. Then you get some strings which in fact appear in hot and dense QCD. So it's not just of academic interest, it has some interest in problems which have experimental area. Now, my main result and my main concern today is in the last year or two, we decided to expand our studies, in particular decided to take an f equal to 2n. Then, why it is a special case? Because with n equal 2 super Young Mielsen and an f equal to 2n, the bulk theory would be conformal. The coupling constant doesn't run. And the only conformality breaking is due to the Fayet-Leopold term, which is, of course, dimensional, but it is not renormalized, as we know. So all interesting effects appear only because of the presence of this non-vanishing Fayet-Leopold term. It is beta function. U1 is not conformal. Yeah, you are right. But SUN is conformal, yes. Now, what appears, this is the simplest example of what I call non-abelian strings, and you will see why it is non-abelian. Let's consider as U2 case, SU2 cross U1 gauge theory. And let's here, SU2 cross U1. Normally, you would say that SU2 pi 1 of SU2 is trivial. You can always contract a circle, a closed contour on a sphere to nothing. So pi 1, only what remains is pi 1 of U2, which will bring you back to the Abrikosov string with all its known features. Now the ansatz for the string solution corresponding to Abrikosov. Okay, I have to explain the vacuum structure. For the vacuum structure, forget about this factor. Oh my God. It's okay here. Okay, I should not move. You know, with SU2 gauge group and two flavors, the hypermultiplet can be described by two indices. It's a square matrix, 2 by 2. One index is color and another is flavor. Okay? So it's very easy to see that the vacuum structure is as follows. If you use this matrix notation, it's the unit matrix proportional to the square root of the Fayette-Leopoldus parameter. That's the vacuum structure which makes the vacuum energy to vanish. So it is the only supersymmetric solution to vacuum. The vacuum is fully, as I said, the theory is fully Higgs, and the vacuum, therefore, the theory is fully Higgs, and the vacuum is an isolated point. It's not a manifold, a continuous manifold of vacuum. It's just a vacuum. Okay, now it's clear why this vacuum can serve diagonal SU2. Color acts as an SU2 matrix from the left. Flavor acts as an SU2 matrix from the right. Generically, if you take different matrices, the vacuum is not invariant. But if this matrix from the right is equal to minus to matrix from the left in the minus first power, they can be commuted with the unit matrix, and the vacuum state stays intact. So it's obviously SU2 is the symmetry of the model. And this solution, Abrikosov-Nielsen-Olsen solution, doesn't break it because it rotates this matrix as a whole. Now let's consider another solution, which is a little trickier. We will rotate only the upper element of the matrix along the large circle in the perpendicular planes, keeping this intact. This is only possible because You see, because this group, which I wrote here, is not quite exact formula. You know, U1 and SU2 have two elements in common, plus one and minus one. These are these are the elements. If SU2 you describe as a sphere, right, which is always possible. This is the north pole and the south pole of this sphere. The center. These are center of the group, right? They belong to both U1 and SU2. So in fact, you have divide by the, in order not to do double counting, you divide by Z2. And then there is an untrivial topology because pi 1 of U1 times SU2 divided by Z2 is not trivial, it's Z2 in itself. It's not Z, but it's Z2, which means that two strings parallel to each other will be collapsible to nothing, right? They will be, but one string is still topologically stable. How it is done? You have a SU2 is a sphere. You start when you go around the large circle in the perpendicular place. You first start going from the north pole to the south pole in SU2, and then from the south pole to the north pole in U1. And the poles are fixed. You cannot leave them, so it's a non-contractable circle. And you see, if you take the tau 3 root, and you can either add or subtract tau 1, you can rotate in the one direction or in the opposite direction with tau 3, you get either the upper element rotating by a phase or the lower element rotating by a phase. So here comes a very interesting effect, the symmetry of the vacuum as SU2. on the string solution, it is broken down to U1, because now you see it's not a SU2 invariant matrix ansatz. It is invariant only under tau 3 rotations. So it means that there is a whole family of the string solutions, and a new modulus appears on the string, which describes the embedding of this tau 3 into SSU2. It's clear you can now rotate tau 3 arbitrarily in SU2. You still have a solution. So actually the moduli fields on the string world sheet interact through the, they live on the coset space, SU2 divided by 1, this extra orientational moduli. And this is O3 or CP1 sigma model, which is of course very well studied. So we have two types of moduli for such solutions. One is the translational moduli, and another is orientational moduli, which is classically, it's a completely, totally massless. Quantum mechanical fate is a special story, which I will discuss later. So the space in which moduli fields live in this model is the following. It's R4 times this cassette space. So you may view it as a six-dimensional string with two dimensions compactified on a sphere. Of course, it is still a non-critical string, because here's it two appears. You see, I remembered I put it somewhere. Because of non-conformality of the bulk space, the theory on the string world sheet is also non-conformal. It's a six-dimensional with certain compactification. According to Stromer-Gerpanchinsky terminology, it's not UV complete. If you want to quantize it, including UV degrees of freedom, you will have to add terms with higher derivative on the string world sheet. And it's a totally different story. Of course, if you would be able to add everything, this is a good theory. It appeared as a topological soliton in a perfectly well-defined bulk theory. The theory in two dimensions is good too. But it is not good if you limit yourself only to two derivatives. And their iteration, Alain Ambu-Gatto, it's a different type of iteration. So here I draw the picture of this model. This is the string. It corresponds to X perpendicular fluctuations. And also at every point of the string, O3 is a unit vector, which can slide over, its endpoint slides over two-dimensional sphere. It can slide at each point of the string, it slides, and there is a derivative coupling between them. Okay, now I would try to draw the evolution of the SU2 coupling, and it's quite kind of interesting. This is the bulk for dimensional theory. We all know that this is it's asymptotically free field theory. The coupling constant grows to smaller energies logarithmically at one loop, so that is gross. This is the point on the scale. This is the point shows the mass squared of the Higgs gauge bosons, and I mentioned all of them have one and the same mass. That's the origin to answer the Natchez question. They are all equal to each other, and all participate equally in the construction of this solution. And as a result of this equality, this extra moduli appeared as a reflection. Now, what happens? Here, of course, the gauge coupling freezes because everything is Higgsed. Okay? However, on the string world sheet, there is a sigma model, which CP1 for n equal to 2, but it is CPn minus 1 for n equal to arbitrary n. And it's a strongly coupled field theory. And if you draw the plot from here and upwards, you draw the plot of the coupling constant in this CPn minus 1 theory, there is no singularity right here. It picks up exactly where the bulk theory ends, and it is exactly the same curve. Okay? If you would have two observers, one in the bulk, another in the string, and they would report the results of their measurements, and compare them, they won't notice anything right here. Okay, I have only 10 minutes, so this is trivial, I explained. Maybe here I make one remark. I already made it in response to Zohar's question. This is the, okay, I will. So if you want to solve, I will need it, but if you want to solve 2,2 CPN model in the sector of the rotational moduli, which are, it's a non-flat sector. R4 is trivial, but this is non-flat sector. The best way to do so is to use the so-called gauge formalism invented by Witten. Twice, in fact, invented and then reinvented. The model is described by, CP1, by a doublet of complex fields N. Here N, complex conjugate. And here N with a constraint which follows from here, E squared tends to infinity, so it's constrained N squared is equal to 2 beta, and beta is the same as 1 over G squared, the inverse coupling constant. Now, four real fields, N and then tilde, four real fields with one real constraint would make 3. In order to make 2, to make S2, you have to gauge the theory. You see, this is U1 gauging, and this is U1 gauging. And then you don't add the dynamical kinetic term, so this is just subtracting one field out. You stay with the two-dimensional surface, and this is exactly O3 or CP1. So in the general case, is 2n degrees of freedom in the field n, and then minus 1, this is this constraint, and minus 1, U1 gauging. Okay, now we go to the most interesting case, which is a new case, when nf equal to 2nc. We can again build. I mentioned that the theory is almost conformal, not quite, because of U1 and because of the Fayet-Leopoldus term. But the number of flavors is now larger, and because of this, the vacuum now in the bulk is not a single point. There is a flat manifold, flat directions in the vacuum. But still, you can build, again, BPS-saturated string-like solution. But it's now not CPN. Why it's not CPN? Because of the flat direction on the vacuum. First of all, we have the same translational modes. We have similar orientational modes, albeit more. No, the same number. And we have what is called the size moduli, which are due to the fact that the cloud created by the string can be of any perpendicular size. It's exactly like the Belavin-Polyakov instanton in the CP1 model, right? It has its size rho, and the phase of this, and the phase which goes to it, U1 phase, and they together combine in a complex modulus, which is called the size modulus. Here we have a number of them. So if we go, this is the general representation. It's called the weighted CP n, n model. It's exactly the same or very similar to the previous CPN model. But now you have two types of complex field, n and rho. N describe the same orientational degrees of freedom. Rho describe the size degrees of freedom. There are two N's and two rows, both complex. There is one U1 gauging, but you see this: the charges of N fields and rho fields are opposite. This U1 charge is plus 1, and this is minus 1. That's why it's called weighted CPN. Some matter fields are weighted with the electric charge 1, other with the charge minus 1, and their amount is the same, and this is the D term, the Fayet-Leopoldus term constraint. You see, now N squared and rho squared enter with the opposite sign here too. So the constraint will be N squared minus rho squared is equal to 2 beta squared.
So
No, let's, okay, I will try to answer. I have only 5 or 6 minutes. Let's assume that E is infinity, okay? I wrote it in this way, but I could have written constraint just without the Lagrange multiplier separately, okay? So this is again one condition. Gauging is another one condition, but we have more moduli fields now. It's easy to calculate the dimensionality of this space. And for n equal to 2, it is 6. Yeah, I'm finishing. If we take n equal to 2, and you will see that why I want to have n equal to 2, the dimension of this weighted CPN model, which we get, which is WCP2, 2, it has dimension 6, because you have 8 degrees of freedom in rows and ends, minus 1 constraint, and minus 1 gauging, 6. Plus 4 translational moduli, which totally decouple. You see, we are on the right way. The string, which appears in this way, is 10-dimensional already. And moreover, this weighted CP2, 2 model is conformal. So we have on a string world sheet a 10-dimensional conformal theory, okay? And as I will show you momentarily, it's fully satisfied the requirement of Strominger and Palczynski of UV completeness. You can quantize this theory consistently with a ghost, which introduces a contribution to the Virasoro central charge. And you don't need higher derivatives. This is, will be a physically consistent theory. You can physically justify the absence of the higher derivative to this end. You have to ensure that the tension of the string times r squared, the inverse size, I'm sorry, the size of the string in the perpendicular direction, is much less than 1. In the parameters of the model we have, that means that t times beta over t should be much less than 1, which means that beta must be less than 1 and the coupling constant must be larger than 1. So physically, if you want a physical picture behind that, you have to go to strong coupling, okay? So strong coupling is different. Here we have an assumption that when you go to strong coupling, at a certain point on the way, beta reaches 0. Then its condition would be satisfied physically. Now, very quickly, I reiterate what we achieved. We build inside the four-dimensional, fully well-defined Young-Mills theory with no anomalies or whatever, no subtle points. We build a string solution. In four-dimensional field theory, we build a string solution which, in addition to 4 translational moduli, trivial R4, forms a six-dimensional Calabi, because weighted CP2, 2 is a six-dimensional Calabi-Yau manifold, known in the literature, okay? It's non-compact. That's an, I don't know, bad or good feature, because most of people compactify the 10-dimensional strings on compact Calabi-Yaus. But then you go along the road which you already know. You know that a massless spin 2 graviton appears and in four-dimensional sense, and all other consequences ensue momentarily. We don't want the massless spin 2 meson. Yeah, I'm finishing. We don't want it to appear, because this is not an abstract construction for the theory of everything. It's a construction inside a four-dimensional Young-Mills theory in the bulk, fully defined. And from Weinberg-Witten theorem, we know that there can be no spin 2 massless particles in such a theory. Okay? So what do we do? here I checked, I'm sorry, I missed one transparency. I checked here that the Virasoro central charge in this theory is expressible, of course, through the central charge of the weighted CP model, and this is well known in the literature. And if you include minus 10 from the Ghost contribution, you get the central charge, Virasoro central charge equal to 0 if n is equal to 2. But I already told that. So it's a critical string theory, period. What differs is that the physical meaning of six extra... I told sex, I'm sorry, not sex. Not the physical meaning of sex, but the physical meaning of six extra moduli is totally clear. It's very graphic, and we know where it comes from. Okay, we know that this Calabi-Yau, the origin of the Calabi-Yau. And we can try the last thing I say. That's my last transparency. We try to see whether indeed there is a massless four-dimensional spin two mesons, which would be indeed disastrous. To this end, we do the standard thing. We take the metric, we split it into two functions. One depend on our four coordinates, another on six coordinates of Calabi-Yau. So, and then we try to find the zero modes for H of J. And by we, I mean Alexei Jung and myself. For this particular non-compact Calabi-Yau, we tried very hard and we found not a single normalizable zero mode. And then accidentally I had a conversation with Kumbrenwaffe, and he said that we were stupid because the number of zero modes is determined by certain indices, and every stupid schoolboy knows that there are no H0 modes in this case, and the zero modes are only scalar. So this is our constraint, that strong coupling, as I said, beta goes to zero. So constraint with beta would be a conifold, but when beta goes to zero, it's a conifold with singularity. It has to be resolved. There are two ways to resolve, deformed or resolved conifold. Okay? In case of result, there are two indices which govern the number of zero mode and their nature. This I learned from Kumbrenwaffe after half a year of reading his papers, or few months of reading of his papers. So both are possible, either one to another, either deformed or non-deformed. If a result, in the result case, there are no normalizable zero modes in six dimensions at all, so it's a not interesting theory. In the deformed conifold, one is non-zero, which implies one normalizable mode, one scalar hypermultiplet. Yeah, that's all. So if you go this is a prediction. If you go in this bulk theory to strong coupling, somehow, remember we had a number of massless hypers. Some of them were written by Higgs mechanism completely, nothing remained of them. But some of them, because the number NF was larger than F, than NC, there were two massless hypers in the bulk theory. And now, if we believe that this is a honest to God critical string theory, Kumbrenwaffe teaches us that there should remain only one massless scalar hypermultiplet. I don't know of a direct way of checking it because I don't know how to solve the bulk theory at small Fayet-Leopoulos term when it becomes strongly coupled. But if I believe that it is something really interesting or adequate, then I should say that. So my conclusions are very brief. We found, I believe, for the first time a topological soliton in four-dimensional Young-Mills theory in the bulk with some degree of supersymmetry, which represents a 10-dimensional critical string in the standard meaning of this word, including this UV completeness a la Strominger and Palczynski. Why do we need four? First, I already said in the previous transparency that we have a non-trivial prediction, if this is correct. We have a non-trivial prediction that one massless hyper, which present at weak coupling, should somehow, two present at weak coupling, one should only remain after transition to strong coupling. Second, which also is exciting to me, that finally I understand the physical meaning, at least in this particular example, of this procedure of compactifying, quote unquote, six extra dimensions. And here, in this example, it's a very graphic and transparent procedure, and there is no, you know, in principle, you don't have to have 10-dimensional world at all. You start from 4-dimensional world, but this, your solution has six extra moduli, and you know their meaning, you get a 10-dimensional string. So, and I finish with a general slogan of this conference, happy birthday to David. Happy birthday. Why do I care about what? Yeah. No, but I need to have 10 dimensions. I want to have a string which has a Virasoro, including this minus 10 Gauss contribution, which has zero Virasoro central.
With 1, 1 Virasoro.
Yes. Yes. Well, I don't know. That's because I read this in the book. Maybe you can help me. Huh? No answer. I had no time. You know, I was reading Kumbrun-Waffe for such a long time that I prepared this transparency on my way here, you know, to Jerusalem. Apparently, it will require few months more, you know.
Okay.
Yeah?
So I have two questions.
Yeah?
Why do you think that this beta parameter goes to zero for any value of the, for some value of the coupling? Why does it always stay positive?
This is the only assumption. I will tell you where it is. Okay. Play. Okay. You see, with the G squared, there is a tricky point. Because weighted CP 2,2, weighted CP 2,2 model has a duality. Okay? If you change G squared into 1 over G squared, then the size moduli become orientational moduli, and orientational moduli become size moduli. Beta is equal to 1 over g squared. It's only a quasi-classical expression. In general, it's not valid beyond quasi-classics. So in order to have strong coupling, we have a conjecture that right in the middle, in where this self-duality takes place, you know, the passage from rho to n, beta, in fact, which is quasi-classically 1 over g squared, in fact, has some kind of singularity. So it makes no sense to say, let's take g squared very large. Because when g squared becomes very large, I make the transformation, and I get the very same weighted CP 2,2 model on the string world sheet, but now it is with a weak coupling. So the only point where something can happen is around this transition. And by symmetry, I guess that it's a g squared to 1. Okay, and the assumption is that at this point, beta becomes very small. Because if it doesn't become very small, then this string, strictly speaking, cannot be a critical string. Then you have, at least from, you can say, okay, forget about it. Consider this model, weighted CP 2,2 as just a certain Calabi-Yau to consider your string on, okay? But because we have a physical origin of this model, we wanted more. We wanted the higher order derivative terms to vanish because the string thickness becomes very, very thin, you know. It's not smeared after some point. But this is a conjecture, and we have no clue how to either rule it out or justify it. This is a pure conjecture. So did I justify the title or it's not true?